The complete urinalysis is a critical component of the minimum database. There are three components to the complete urinalysis: the physical, chemical, and microscopic examinations. By far, the most problematic to the veterinary medical team is the microscopic portion. Microscopic evaluation of the urine allows identification and characterization of both common and much less common formed elements that provide insight into potential underlying urinary tract disease. In this video, we will briefly discuss how to identify cells, including red blood cells, white blood cells, bacteria, squamous and non-squamous epithelial cells, hyaline and non-hyaline casts, and various crystals. When seen individually, there is little challenge in their identification. However, when evaluating them mixed with other formed elements, the challenge is significantly increased. The two most common formed elements we find in urine samples are red blood cells and white blood cells. The key to their identification in the urine sediment is that they have similar morphologic features as they do in the peripheral blood. They are small, uniformly sized round structures, with white blood cells being slightly larger than the red blood cells. The next key feature is that the red blood cells have no internal granular structures, whereas the white blood cells have a granular appearance due to the cytoplasmic granules and the presence of a nucleus. In this high power field of view of an unstained urine specimen, there are primarily numerous white blood cells with a lower relative number of red blood cells. The granular nature of the slightly larger white blood cells and the lack of this granularity of the slightly smaller red blood cells allows relatively simple distinction between the two cell types. The significant numbers of white blood cells indicates the presence of inflammation, which could be infectious or non-infectious in nature. Red blood cells are commonly seen as a component of the inflammatory process, but they may also be seen as vastly predominating cell population associated with trauma or possible urinary calculi. The presence of either cell type indicates that further investigation is required. In this video, the granular cells larger than the predominating white blood cells are non-squamous epithelial cells. In this case, the non-squamous epithelial cells are transitional epithelial cells. In contrast to erythrocytes and leukocytes, epithelial cells are larger and more variable in size and shape. These cells originate from a variety of sources, and their presence may be dependent on various urine collection techniques. Low numbers of epithelial cells are commonly noted in the urine sediment of a clinically normal animal because of normal sloughing of old cells from the various epithelial surfaces. These cells can originate from numerous sources in the urogenital tract, including renal tubules, renal pelvis, urethra, urinary bladder, and external genitalia such as the vagina and prepuce. In this video, there are increased numbers of epithelial cells, but they are mixed with numerous white cells and lower numbers of red blood cells, as well as bacteria. This is a very common finding with inflammation. When epithelial cells are seen in conjunction with an active inflammatory process, hyperplasia of epithelial cells and not neoplasia is most likely. In contrast, when epithelial cells are found in high numbers in the absence of active inflammation, strong consideration for transitional cell carcinoma must be made. In this video, epithelial cells predominate. Note the moderate variability in cell size. Diagnosis of transitional cell carcinoma should not be made by just evaluating the wet preparation. Preparing an air-dried slide for staining and pathology review would be strongly recommended. Bacteria are a common finding in the urine sediment exam. They can appear either from infection of the urogenital tract or from contamination. Ultimately, the urine culture is the definitive test for urinary tract infection. A second category of formed elements of a urine specimen is the cast. Casts are cylinders of material that have been collected within the distal nephron tubular structures of the kidney. They are relatively insensitive indicators of kidney injury. However, when identified, the presence of casts provides highly specific information regarding kidney injury. In many cases, the identification of the different types of casts provides information regarding the degree and type of injury present in the kidneys. The four basic types of casts include hyaline, cellular, granular, and waxy casts. Differentiating between these different types of casts is most important. With practice, characterizing the cast as broad or narrow is possible, and this additional information may be helpful in characterizing the presence of significant renal compromise and compensation. From a diagnostic perspective, characterizing casts into two basic categories, hyaline and non-hyaline casts, is all that is needed in most situations. Hyaline casts may be seen with simple dehydration in the otherwise clinically normal animal. In most cases, they are composed mostly of TAM horsefall mucoprotein secreted from the renal tubular epithelial cells. Hyaline casts may also be seen with protein-losing glomerulopathy. Therefore, their identification can be highly significant. Hyaline casts are the most difficult casts to identify because the refractive index of the cast itself is so similar to the surrounding urine fluid. And if the light source on the microscope is not set properly, they are easily missed. A third important formed element of the urine specimen is the crystal. Crystals are commonly formed elements found in many urine specimens, but the majority of the crystals identified have little clinical significance. The formation of crystals is dependent upon several physical factors, including pH, temperature, concentration of the urine itself, and the solubility of the components in the urine. In general, the more cool a urine specimen is, the greater the number of crystals will be found. Refrigerated urine specimens may have many more crystals than freshly collected warm urine. The identification of the type of crystal present may aid in the detection of underlying disorders predisposing an animal to urolith. They may help predict the composition of the urolith that are known to be present, and potentially may help monitor therapy instituted to dissolve urolith that have been identified. Bilirubin crystals may form in the urine of animals in typically acidic urine specimen. The crystals are needle-like and yellow-red to reddish-brown and relatively easily identified. In highly concentrated urine from dogs, bilirubin crystals may be formed because bilirubin is normally found in dog urine. If present in large numbers repeatedly, especially in mildly concentrated urine specimens, increased conjugated bilirubin excretion associated with abnormalities in bilirubin metabolism, primarily cholestasis, should be suspected. These cases should also have detectable bilirubinuria on the chemistry dry reagent strip. In the example on the previous slide, there are many leukocytes and bacteria in the background. Calcium carbonate crystals are commonly seen in horse and rabbit urine specimens. They are present in alkaline urine and typically demonstrate no clinical significance. They are typically small, colorless crystals that are present in dumbbell or spherical forms with potential internal striations. And in most cases, a wide range of morphologic presentations are seen relative to different stages of formation of these crystals. Calcium carbonate crystals are not described in dog and cat urine specimens. If similar-shaped crystals are found in the dog or cat urine, they are more likely to be representative of a form of calcium oxalate monohydrate crystals. Cystine crystalluria is never considered normal, and when present, suggests an underlying metabolic disorder. These crystals are typically identified as six-sided or hexagonal, colorless, plate-like crystals. The various sides of the crystals are typically equal in length. Amorphous phosphate crystals are relatively common in alkaline urine specimens, and they have no clinical significance. They are described as granular precipitates with no definitive shape, and they are morphologically indistinguishable from amorphous urate crystals. However, the amorphous urate crystals are seen in acid urine specimens. The primary importance for amorphous phosphate crystal identification is to assure that they are not misidentified as cocci bacterial forms. This is a great application of the air-dried and stained preparation of a concentrated urine specimen. A variety of drug-related crystals may be seen in the urine sediment. Whenever a crystal is identified that is not readily recognized, a drug-associated crystal should be suspected, and detailed clinical historical information relative to therapy is warranted. Sulfonamide drugs are relatively definable and represent the most commonly encountered drug-associated crystalluria in dogs and cats. Sulfur crystals are often shaped like sheaves or bundles of needle-like crystals. Oftentimes, these needle-like crystals will appear in a fan-shaped configuration. This video hopefully has proven to be an introduction of the various elements commonly encountered in the urine sediment examination. The information obtained from the urine sediment is critical to the accurate interpretation of the complete urinalysis, especially in the context of the minimum database. For additional information and resources, please check out our IDEXX website.